Welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop. Today's episode is sponsored in part by Highland Woodworking. Visit their website at highlandwoodworking.com. And also by Lee Valley and Veritas. Visit their website at leevalley.com. In the previous episode, we cut the plywood for the doors to their final dimensions. As you can see, I've wrapped solid walnut stock around the exposed plies to give the doors a bit of a framed look. Now, I intentionally left the solid stock a little thicker than I needed so I could make minor adjustments to it for a nice, clean, finished look when the hinges are finally installed and the doors are in place. I start trimming the wrapped walnut with my block plane. Really, when it comes down, it only takes a few passes, so pay close attention to how much stock is coming off and check the fit often. In fact, we'll discuss more about this at the end of today's episode. Now, once the doors are trimmed and my reveals are where I want them, it's time to start installing the hinges. So I do this by marking a few measurements so I know exactly where the hinge cups need to be drilled, along with the pilot holes for the screws to hold them in place. I measure in from the top and bottom approximately 1/5 the height of the door. In this case, it worked out to about 4 3/4 of an inch at each end. The next measurement is to come in from the edge. This time, it's approximately 57 1/64 of an inch. You know, a nice round number. And then I'll repeat this both at the top and bottom on each one of the doors. Next, I grab my scratch awl and then I dimple the surface to create a nice little starter hole for the large Forstner bit we'll be using to drill out the recess for the hinge cup. Now, I mentioned it was a large Forstner bit, right? In this case, we're using a 1 3/8 inch bit to remove the material for the hinge cup. And then stopping periodically to make sure it's at the right depth. In this case, we want to drill until the top of the bit is just flush with the surface. By sneaking up on the final depth, we help to guarantee we don't go through the other side. And you know, if you go a little deeper than the hinge cup needs to be, don't worry about it. As long as you don't penetrate the other side, you're safe. Just to make sure where we want to be, I check the fit with one of the hinges. It drops in place right where I want it. To install the other half of the hinge assembly, I decided rather than fumbling with my adjustable squares and tape measures, using a small story stick would help speed up the process. The first line I registered was to establish the distance up from the bottom of the case. This next line is to establish a center line at this height in from the front edge. Notice I'm basing it on the back of the solid stock versus the front. This is because for some reason, my face frames weren't perfectly flush with each other, but I know the plywood is. Now this next set of marks I'm doing, I already have marked on the story stick exactly the distance for where the screws that will help hold the hinge assembly in place. So it's just a matter of marking those and then once again using that distance in from the front edge once more based on the back side of the solid stock. I can create the exact center lines that I need, so once I put the hinge assembly in position, the screws will go exactly where they need to be, and I can guarantee that it's going to be nice and parallel with that front edge. Using my scratch awl again, I simply dimple the surface to locate the screws for the hinge assembly. Now, because I want more control over how the screws are being installed, I chose to go with a good old-fashioned screwdriver versus my drill. Ah, who am I kidding? I really wanted to show off my pretty screwdriver more than anything else. But seriously though, hand-tightening screws to their final depth isn't a bad habit to get into. It'll help to ensure that you don't strip the screws or even blow through the back side. And on top of it, really, it doesn't take that long to do it. Then to finish the hinge cup installation, it's a matter of dropping it in place, squaring it up with your adjustable square on the edge, and once that's in place, just simply grab your scratch awl, dimple the surface, and you'll install the screws just as you did with the hinge assembly. Periodically to make sure that the hinge cup stays square to the edge. Once both halves of this style of hinge are installed, it's a matter of snapping them in place and then adjusting for that perfect reveal. So in today's episode, we covered a number of topics, and I was trying to figure out which one would be a really good one to do some more follow-up on the second half of this episode. Now, it could be fitting the doors so that they gave us a nice reveal in the opening, or it could have been maybe more about the hinges. And then I also was trying to decide if maybe talking about the story stick might be a good topic. And to be honest with you, all three are really good ones. I think the story stick and the hinges could easily be topics on their own for another day. So we're gonna save those for much later on down the line, especially the hinges. When it comes to European style hinges, there are different varieties of them. And also we could contrast and compare those to regular hinges that we think of, more traditional hinges. So instead, what we're gonna talk about for the rest of this episode is we're gonna talk about that applied beading that I put around the doors, and not only attaching it, but I'm going to show you how I cut it, and then more importantly, I'm going to show you how I adjusted it so that it fit within the opening. So what we got here is we have a nice little frame that we're going to start out with, and I made a door that's going to fit into the middle of it. And like I said, we're going to start with cutting it, and then we're going to glue it on and get it adjusted, and then we're going to have it fit inside the reveal inside here with a nice reveal. Now, when it comes to the beading, there are a couple of different ways that we could do this. Number one, if we were working with some solid stock, it'd be very easy to use like a scratch stock or a scratch a tool that would allow you to go around and literally scratch that profile into the edges of the board, so that you would still just be using one piece and then applying that. You could do the same thing with router bits also by applying a profile from your favorite router bit. One problem, of course, is the fact that we used plywood in today's episode, and then, of course, we're going to be using plywood for this particular example. So really, when it comes down to it, you could maybe do it with the router bit, but you're going to see those plies in there. If you're painting it, that's no big deal. It's just going to cover it right up, and nobody would ever be the wiser. But because we are using the plies and we're going to be staining this, or actually just simply applying a clear finish, I don't want to deal with that. So we're going to be using a solid wood beading that's going to go around the outside. And to be honest with you, this almost kind of opens up more options for us, because we could maybe potentially use a contrasting wood for the beading. And in fact, you'll notice that we are going to be doing that. I have some walnut left over from the Walnut Buffet, and we're going to use that on this light colored birch just to help it stand out a little bit more, to give you a better idea. So let's go ahead and head over to the workbench, and we're going to get started first with getting the beading to the proper size, cutting it with a miter saw. In fact, we're going to be using that miter saw right there to do the cutting, and I'll explain why in just a second. Once we get that cut, we're going to, of course, glue it in, come back, and then we're going to adjust it so that it fits in the opening here and gives us a nice reveal all the way around. Okay, so we have this thin beading that I cut previously for the Walnut Buffet, and we had a little bit left over. Always like to make sure I have a little extra stock. It comes in around about a quarter of an inch, and I just simply cut it on my table saw. But that's a topic, of course, we can come back to and discuss a little bit more, cutting thin stock like this. We have a few different jigs and options for doing it. But what we're essentially going to be doing is, let me just set this here, we're going to be wrapping this mini sample of a door with the stock. And it seems like it should be really easy, and basically it is. It's very straightforward. Now, I already had cut a 45 degree on the ends of each of these, and that's just to kind of get us started, because what we're really going to do is come in here and we're just going to match these up, and this is much easier setting them down on the table. So we'll do a over my shoulder in just a second to get a look at it. But this kind of gives us an idea of where we're headed to. Now, let's go ahead and head to the table. We'll kind of set this up again, and I'll show you how I mark it off so I know where to make my next cut for the next 45 degree. And we'll do that on the miter saw. And when it comes down to it, it's very, very simple. So we have the little sample door sitting here on the bench, and my hands are going to kind of be in the way a little bit just to get this first part going. This is where having that first 45 degree on our pieces work out great, because we can kind of get this adjusted where we want it.
we get them set up here, make sure that they are exactly the way we want it, which it is, so that way one's not overlapping the other. We then, what I like to do is, oh, I moved it a little bit, there we go. Okay, get this in place. What I'm gonna do then is hold this one in position, take my pencil, a nice sharp pencil, and I'm gonna mark whereabouts I need to make that first cut. And you can see the pencil line there. What I'm then gonna do is, I'm gonna take my square and we'll come up from the bottom here. And once again, we'll grab our pencil and, sorry, my hand's in the way. Not right-handed, but we'll just do this anyhow. This is just a matter of scribing another line. So we have that marked just a little bit better. We're gonna head over to the miter saw, and just to be on the safe side, I'm gonna draw a line over on the edges just to indicate where that goes. Of course, we want, since we have this 45 going that way, we want this one to go this way. So I will indicate that on both sides, just in case I try to figure out which way is better to hold on the miter saw. So now we're ready to take this piece and cut it. Now, what I wanna do is, of course, we're gonna cut that 45. So I need to turn my blade so that the 45 is coming from this side. And this is the piece that I wanna use on the door. And what I like to do is make sure that I'm holding it tight against the fence, just so that way it's not gonna move around on me. And to get the best cut, I wanna have my hand as close to where it's gonna be going so there's less chatter. Using a miter saw is fantastic for this because I don't have to worry about a blade spinning around and my hand being too close to it. And to be honest with you, a nice sharp blade, I can sneak up on this and get amazing results with very little fuss at all. And again, like I said, I don't have to worry about my hand being in the way. So we have the mark where we want it, and I'm just gonna look from this side. So I adjusted it. I want it to be more on this side. That way, if once we make the cut, we need to make a small adjustment, I have more stock and I can kind of remove it. If I did it on the other side, well, yeah, you can't put stock back on. So here we go. All right, there I've got my my piece cut, and then we'll just go ahead and check it on the door, make sure it looks good, and then we'll repeat the same thing with all the other sides. In fact, we can use this now because we have that other 45, so this could be our wrap to continue around the door. Nice thing about that is we then get this nice wraparound look if we are concerned with that. So here's the scrap that we have left over from that cut we just made. And I don't know if you can kind of see the detail in there, but we have a little bit of fraying from the blade. Eh, you come to expect it, even with a sharpish blade. I've been using this one quite a bit. So what I do to just clean that up so I can use this one in the next thing is I just come in with my chisel, and it's just a matter of just holding it and just cleaning it up a little bit. And now, set that down so I don't hurt myself. Now this is nice and flat and ready for the next cut. So now what we're gonna do is, once we have that first piece cut, we'll just go ahead and mark for our next pieces. We'll do this the rest of the way around, cut those, and then we'll come back to glue it all up. And then once that's done, we'll make the adjustments. Okay, so we have our four pieces and we're gonna go ahead and kind of line them up. I'm not too worried about getting the grain matched up perfect. This is just an example. But what I do like to do is start out with one side, make sure that that looks good. All right, we're gonna hold this in place. That looks good. There's a little overlap like there is on this corner. No big deal. We'll fix that in the adjustment. So now it's a matter of starting the glue up. And since I'm gluing this right up directly to some plywood, we'll just go ahead and put this glue on here, get this first one in. And we'll start with this next. One thing I am gonna highly recommend is before you start applying the glue, make sure that you smooth these faces down as much as you can, because if there's any major imperfections in there, that will definitely start to show more in the gluing. And that's not exactly what we want. Now, you can, if you wanted to, apply a little glue to the miters to help keep them closed. Always a good idea, actually. In fact, we should go back over here and do the same here. We'll just apply a little there. There we go. That will help to keep those nice and tight. Okay, that looks pretty good. Let's just make this. Got to quit playing around with it, Matt. One thing I do like to do is I like to use these little spring clamps. They do a great job of holding everything in place. You have to be careful, though, because they will leave a little dimple on the surface, and I'll show you that, but you can easily correct that without any issue. Let's go ahead and get this in place. And we're just about ready to attach the glue to this one. And I'm holding these down in place right now because I was just realizing I should have had a clamp along the faces, because these spring clamps will actually pull the pieces over, especially ones this small. So let's go ahead and get this in, get another clamp in place, and then I can finally let go. So let's go here. All right, that's good. And then one more spring clamp, and we should be set, and then we just gotta let these dry. There we go. Nice, these look really good. So we're gonna go ahead and let this glue up, and then we'll be ready to come back and make the adjustments. Okay, so we've removed the spring clamps, and I'm just gonna show you this real quick. If you can kind of see it, these are the type of dimples that I'm talking about. They're really tiny, you can barely notice them. So really when it comes down to it, it's just a matter of just sanding, and it'll actually fill it right in, especially when you go to do your finishing. It's no big deal at all. They're barely noticeable, and since this is essentially a door, again, nobody's gonna really notice it. So we have our piece right here, and we have our makeshift frame. Let's go ahead and drop it in, and as we can see, it's not quite fitting, so let's just try this. All right, there we go, that looks pretty good. But the thing is, if we notice, it's not dropping down into the opening at all. And in fact, we could force it, but it would just cause this to split open. And on top of it, we want to have a nice reveal around all four sides. So this is where we're going to start making our adjustment. We'll remove a little bit from one side and then the other, and then we'll go ahead and do the same on each side. So if we do two passes here, we're going to do two passes here, and then two passes on each one of these until we get it to fit in. Once it fits in, we'll then continue to make slight adjustments to get that final reveal all the way around that we desire. So the tool that we're going to use to adjust this little door is I'm going to use my block plane. Now, if this was a much wider piece, such as say those doors or the drawers that we have for the Walnut Buffet, we would probably we could still use this. In fact, I believe I did use this the most, but at some point I did come in with my smoother, my number four smoother, and finished it off that way, just because of the fact that it would help again to kind of clean out if there was any little dips in here from where it's pressed up against the surface, if there was any unevenness in the panel in the middle. But for this one, for sure, we'll use the block plane. And then it's just a matter of dropping it into the vise. And to get started, we'll just go ahead and make a slight chamfer on the corners, so that way we don't blow the back part out, especially on the adjacent face here. And then, like I said, we'll just make one or two passes. So let's do that next. Okay, so we've got this clamped in, and like I said, we're just going to make a slight chamfer. There we go. To help with controlling any blowout on the backside, we want to pay attention to the grain, of course, and this one looks like we're pretty good. So let's start to make our light pass, and we'll just get ourselves clamped in here much better. And here we go. Almost starting to make a full pass. There we go. One, two. So let's start there. I'm just going to simply rotate this. Looking at the grain, I want to go this direction, which is kind of nice because we already chamfered that from the last pass. And let's see. Okay, we got to get going here. One. Nope. There we go. There's our first full length. So one, two. All right, that looks pretty good. We had a little blowout there, but no problem though. We can fix that. We'll flip this over and let's see here. Where does the grain go? The grain goes this direction. Once again, we'll chamfer that to help minimize any blowout. And let's see here. We're almost, there we go, one full pass. One, two, all right. And this time we need to go this direction. And let's chamfer. All right. Almost right away. So one, two. All right. Let's check how that fits in the frame. Okay, so we have the frame. Now let's go ahead and we can see that we're starting to fall in over here, but for some reason, not all the way around. So let's make another couple adjustments. And let's concentrate on this side and this side first. So again, looking at the grain. One, two, and let's go three. Okay, now we're gonna do the opposite side. Okay, so we've flipped it over. Now let's do the same here. We're gonna do three passes. One, two, oops, three. There we go. All right, let's just concentrate on this one end here because there. I slipped a little, as you could tell when I did that. All right, so let's see. It's getting there. Let's see, do we have there? And see, it's starting to drop down into place more. All right, so we're really, really close. Let's concentrate again on those two sides that we worked on. So it was these two. All right, let's see, we'll look at the end grain, and we should be just about there. One, two, three. Again, we'll flip this. Yep, there's the end grain. Okay, this one, I need to chamfer one more time. Okay. One, two, three. All right. Let's see what we have here. Oops, you're on the wrong. There. Look at how nice that drops in. So, now that we've got it this far, we then want to make an adjustment so that we get a nice reveal all the way around. And this is where we're really close to being done, so we don't have to do that much. So I'm going to say let's do three passes on each one, and then we'll be all set. All right. Oh, yeah. It's a nice reveal. Or if we decide this panel, since this is square anyways, looks good that way. Can't really see the reveal very well, but it is pretty much exactly where we want it. I'm gonna just adjust it a pinch more because I want a little bit more reveal here on the sides. But all in all, it's pretty much done. That's all there really is to adjusting an applied beading all the way around. I always recommend that it goes on a little heavy at first. Just like with any of our cuts, we can always refine it to kind of pull it back so that it's exactly where we want it. But if you start out just a little heavy and then have to take just a few passes here and there, you'll get the look you're going for. The main thing is to make sure that you're consistent on whichever edge it is. So if you're taking two off of this one, make sure you take two off of the bottom one, and vice versa for left and right. Now, one thing I will recommend is once you start sneaking up on that reveal and you get it so that it's actually fitting in and you just want to take off a smidge but you're worried you're going to take off too much, one technique that you can use is if it fits the right way, just simply rather than going straight across, nice and plain with the surface, slightly chamfer it on the outside here so it gives you a little bit more of a reveal, but yet you still have the wood exactly, you know, in the back here where you want it. This is kind of a common technique. I use it quite a bit to help adjust my shadow line. So like I said, if it's fitting exactly perfect and I don't want it too loose, but yet I still want a little bit of a heavier line, what I'll do is I'll just simply come in and drop down that front face a little bit, that it still leaves the back in the plane where we started. I hope that makes sense. It's really basically just a long chamfer, but it works fantastic to give me a uniform reveal line. Really, really great. So if you have any questions, of course, don't hesitate to contact me about this. I use this quite a bit. I love having an applied bead on my projects, especially if I use, let's say, even a router profile, and then I can just cut off like I said, about that quarter inch thickness thin strip, and then use that as an applied beading. It works fantastic. So if you have any comments, questions, suggestions, of course, get a hold of me at mattsbasementworkshop@gmail.com. Don't forget to get your name entered for the swag drawing. We have it coming up in a few weeks, a couple weeks actually, as we're posting this episode. And you want to have an opportunity to win some really great stuff. Check out the swag page to find out what we're giving away this month and make sure you get yourself entered. Enter each month and, well, like I said, you have a chance to win some great stuff. So I think that's pretty much going to do it. Again, if you want to get a hold of me, mattsbasementworkshop@gmail.com, or you can stop by the website at mattsbasementworkshop.com and leave a comment in today's show notes. So until the next episode, I'll be talking to all of you later. Straight grains and sharp blades. Take care, everybody.
To find the show notes and links mentioned in today's episode, visit mattsbasementworkshop.com. There you'll find information on how to subscribe to the show, enter our monthly swag drawings, and more. And while you're there, please consider helping to support the show by visiting our various advertisers and sponsors. By clicking on the links and making purchases, you not only have a chance to buy great tools and services for yourself, but you also have a chance to help support the show.